Kneel at his throne.
It's Torah talk.
Kneel at his throne.
It's Torah talk.
Kneel at his throne.
It's Torah talk.
Kneel.
It's Torah talk.
Gotta live in Torah, Torah, Torah.
It's Torah talk.
We are witnesses and watchmen of Torah.
Welcome to Torah Talk with Lew White and Mark Davidson.
A Torah Institute podcast.
It's the Torah Zone.
We'll be married to Yahusha. Our wedding vows are the Ten Commandments. If you love him, keep them. We show our love by obedience. You can't have one without the other.
Marriage. What does it really mean? Is it just about walking down the aisle, making vows, eating some multi-tiered cake, and wearing wedding rings? Is there a deeper connection to this custom? Is marriage still a good thing? Is it relevant for today? If so, why has such a large percentage of society abandoned it, deeming it irrelevant, restrictive, a bad thing to do? As with any subject in our life, in order to understand the deeper significance and meaning of marriage, we need to consult the one who designed it. Many, many people over the last century have spoken out for and against marriage, and many of them were influenced by ulterior motives and dark forces. Whoa, back up there a bit. Dark forces? Yes, friends, I said it, dark forces, evil spirits, always striving to turn upside down the universal rules, the patterns that were set in motion for a prosperous existence.
Well, brothers and sisters, welcome to Torah Talk. We've just hit our 30th show, brother. 30 shows, that's a lot of talking.
Well, 30 years is the entry point for a priest. That's when a priest can become functional.
Yeah.
And the lips of a priest ought to preserve knowledge.
Mm.
I think that I said that was in Yeshayahu, but it's really in Malachi.
Mm.
Yeah, people look up Malachi. There's only four chapters in Malachi. Mm. But that is a powerful book, you know.
Yes.
So many things.
I would just like to say g'day to our brother Mike, who lives in Baton Rouge, who flew over to Florida, and he's getting married to his beautiful wife. And that's happened already, according to Facebook. He's just been married. So, good on you, Mike.
Praise Yahuwah for that.
Because
he brings people together. Governments don't bring people together. Mm. A lot of people that are more secular-minded think that governments are involved, and they're really not. If you act like you're married before Yahuwah, the state has nothing to do but follow it, you know, and say, well, they must be married, you know. Now, a lot of people today are living together because they won't make that so-called civil commitment of what we call marriage. But in reality, they are married. Mm. It's just that they don't accept it. You know, they haven't made their commitment to the other person, and they don't want to get legally entangled. But they already are, you know. Mm. They just don't realize it.
Well, I've been chatting to a few people, and I've put a couple of messages out on Facebook this week saying that we were going to have this conversation, and if there are any questions. A few people were talking about all the different ordinances and rituals, and most of them were Jewish, that you have to go through, you know, what is it, the kippah, the... You know, all the things that you have to go through and veils and all sorts of things. And so, but according to scripture, in my understanding, you just need to consummate to be married, don't you?
That's really it, yes. You come together physically and you're married. These adulterous and fornicating and all that sort of thing, we were commanded to not partake of those activities because that's what the pagans did. That's the way they were. That's the way they worshipped in the temples, their pagan temples. But in Acts 15, we're given those four things that we should do, you know, and abstain from those four things. And one of those is fornication. Mm. You know, we can't join ourselves to just anybody willy-nilly. Mm. We're united with our wife as one, and we can't defile that bed, you know. Mm. Yeah. But actually, the family is the core unit of the family is built around that union, you know. There's, in fact, if we, there was a radio personality that teaches on Christian radio that was talking about the fact that we wouldn't have any marriage at all. Marriage would not exist in the world to come. He was calling it heaven. When we get to heaven, we would not be seeing any kind of marriages. Well, what he's really looking at is that two-dimensional idea that we're not going to be married to one another, but we're going to be married because that's what is the wedding supper about. It's about a husband, the Creator himself. We call him Yahusha, and he's marrying his bride, which we understand to be the first resurrection group, the first fruits group, and that his body will, of course, increase in size and number, but the bride are those people in a relationship with him through his covenant. And, of course, they would like to think that it's the Christians and they have to convert all the Jewish people, but in fact, the Yahudim, or the Jewish people, are way ahead of the Christians in the covenant, you know, in knowledge of the covenant. Yeah. But
we also had another lady ask a question about, she didn't quite understand the concept of Yahuwah coming down in the flesh, because the law stated that a husband cannot remarry unless he, how does it go again? Unless the husband dies, and she remarries or something like that. And it was fulfilled in what Yahusha did, because he divorced Israel, but then he died. Is that how it goes? So then he's able to remarry again?
Yeah, he could remarry because the husband died, and that ended that contract. But you see, the renewed contract that the Christians call the New Testament is a renewal of that marriage. Mm-hmm. And so it's really interesting, because the whole goal of creation is marriage. When you look at the scriptures from the beginning to the very end, the book of Genesis, or Bereshith, starts out with Yahuwah creating the heavens and the earth, and the fulfillment or the culmination of his creative acts happened to be the man and the woman and their relationship with one another with him. So marriage is actually a three-cord rope. If you realize what it is, then the bond is very, very strong. Mm. So anyway, at the very beginning, we have marriage. And at the very end, we have marriage. And marriage is under attack right now, because the adversary hates marriage. The dragon absolutely hates marriage, because it's obvious that we are going to be his bride. And all the messengers together, you know, even the good ones, are not ever going to be his bride. We are. That's a profound thing to think about. Hmm. But all these beings that he created before he created the first man and woman, they're going to be below us in terms of rank, because we're his bride. Hmm. That's amazing. Yeah. But the ultimate goal of creation must be marriage, because he talks about it at the very end as well. In that relationship, he said, "Am I not a husband to Israel?" You know, we're not talking about the state of Israel. We're talking about his people in a covenant.
Yeah. Hmm.
Marriages are, something that, it's really something that, it doesn't matter how old you are, marriage is a mysterious thing. It's like there's, each sex is like an alien form of life, you know? It's one is just as foreign to the other. Even though they may have common things about them, they seem to be different creatures, you know? And It's like when he separated the first woman from the first man, there was more than we realize that it was separated there. You know, that as I've grown to be with my wife for all these decades, the wife of my youth, I was blessed to be able to stay with. It's been a wild ride. But if you're willing to defer your will to their will, the other person's will, there's no problems. It's only when selfishness enters the thing. And when somebody just, or they make ultimatums, you know, ultimatums are the worst because they feel like they have no power. So the only thing they can do is make an ultimatum. And it might be the man or the woman, but a lot of times it's the woman that's making the ultimatum because she feels so powerless. But she really does wield a lot of control that she maybe doesn't realize. But anyway, the thing of it is, though, we have to understand that in that bond, that covenant we make with our Creator, which is the Ten Commandments, it makes everything make sense when you understand that selfishness is the thing that gets in your way with that, too. You know, if He's not enthroned on your heart and you're doing His will, then you got problems, you know. And he even calls it a covenant of Hasid, which is sometimes translated as a covenant of love between himself and his wife, Yisrael.
We've had a few comments from people saying we've done a few things on marriage, but we haven't really addressed the subject of dating. Do you come across young people in your business or day-to-day and tend to coach them, as you call it, in how to find, because scripture says if you can't contain yourself and you're having all these urges, find a wife or find a husband. So do you have any advice for those sort of people in how they would go about that? I mean, some people would just say, leave it up to Yahuwah, and that's great, but do you have any more specific advice that you would share with young people?
Well, everything that you've said up to now is very basic. It's simple. It's a matter of Abraham sent out his servant to go find a wife for his son, Eliezer, I believe his name was. And he went out and found this girl, and he prayed to Yahuwah to lead him to her. If she says this and does that, then that's the one, and I'm going to propose an offer to her by way of this order that he received from Abraham. Mm. Well, he went out and he sought out the right person in the group of people that you're supposed to look. See, if you're looking for a wife or a husband among the wrong group, like if you go out to a pub or a drinking establishment or some festival or something that's not a place where you'd find one of us, then you're obviously not looking in the right place. But if you look among the group that you're supposed to look among, then that's the first thing to think about. Because if you start making a relationship with an outsider, then you're going to have problems. You know, doctrinal, walking problems, your Sabbath. You look for a Sabbath keeper, person who loves the name and loves the commandments. And among that group, then you're okay. But most of the time in my life, and I'm sure yours too, you see unbelievers. And that's who we're really sent to. And they're already a lot of times living together, or they're dating all sorts of different people. And they're already outside the faith, and the people they're dating are outside the faith. They're just willy-nilly, just going around in the human soup, just looking for other dead people, you know. Dead people looking for dead people.
Yeah.
And they even call themselves zombies, you know. It's becoming like every time something, whenever they need a reason to have a party, they dress up like zombies. They don't even, they have their annual zombie festival, but they have these just sudden get-togethers, you know.
Yeah.
And usually they're outside or inside. But
yeah. It's been a really big week for noticing things like that as far as the belief and the world. A lot of people have put a lot of emphasis on the and we used to too, as a lot of Yahushua's parables was dealing with the believers in the world and things like that. And we're starting to realize now that
the world is kind of irrelevant until they come in, isn't it? I mean, that's who we're called to, and that's who we're living, you know, trying to draw in and guide into the belief. But it's like, don't go looking out there for a mate, you know.
Yeah, if we look just on our human dimension and think of marriage in that sense, we are limiting it, because you see the real covenant of marriage. It's a contract. It's a covenant between two people. And in the big picture, Yahuwah is appealing to his bride that's among the peoples of the earth. And he's calling all to become his bride and in union with him. And because he basically betrothed or married is, because you see in the Hebrew mindset, a betrothal is a marriage. You can call it your husband, you can call her your wife. That's a betrothal, and it's really serious. You know, everybody has to just back off. You know, they're out of the game for, you know, as far as people that are wanting to maybe mess with them as a potential mate.
On the prowl.
On the prowl. Yeah. But the greatest shalom or completion is through the relationship of the covenant. And great peace is, like you were quoting Psalm 119, verse 165. You remember that one? Mm. And that was a wonderful verse. Mm. But he married Israel at Mount Horeb or Mount Sinai, and that's what he did, because he had seized his wife to be from Mitzrayim or Egypt. He seized by a strong hand and by an outstretched arm. He took her, you know, out of there. Mm. And of course, we know him as the 12 tribes. Mm. And anyway, how would we define marriage? Well, hopefully we can cover some of that. And how does a couple marry? And who did Yahuwah marry? Well, and within those, we have topics like, what is the everlasting love spoken of in Yirmiyahu or Jeremiah 31, verse 3? And that the greatest love is described by Yahusha at Yehuchanan or John 15, 13. And we have on record that as far as divorce is concerned, Malachi 2, verse 16, he hates it, you know. Mm. So we don't want to do anything he hates. Mm. So, and he doesn't want to divorce us, you know. We're the unfaithful wife, you know, if we're outside the covenant. Mm. So have you got the slides up there yet?
I certainly do, yes.
Excellent. What's slide 6 start with?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. As goes marriage, so goes the nation. Have I got the same numbers as you?
Yes.
Great.
I haven't changed these at all. Well, yeah, that's true. As goes marriage, so goes the nation. If you weaken the family, you weaken the nation. And the nation is, of course, we're speaking of as a nation of people like Australia or the United States or any of the countries of the world. Every country has within it families, and the families are either strong or they're weak. And if the families are weak, and that means the marriage is weak, because the family is only weak because the marriage is weak. And Rome declined due to a decline in the strength of the family unit. And population growth suffered as a result. And decadent moral behavior was the result of the decline of the family. In other words, we were just grabbing people and saying, let's hang out together. And then societies are showing the signs of family stress right now, especially this country. It seems like more and more this country that I live in the news, there's just bad news about families and marriage. People don't even want to get married because they hear such horrible stories, you know.
That's true about the marriage. Chris was saying something really interesting this week. He was saying about the marriage, the husband and wife. He was saying that because there's so much moral, I guess, depravity or decadence going on in the world, and people are just out there satisfying themselves or with other partners or everything, and not in the marriage covenant. When the husband, I mean, you know, as a man, you have urges. When the husband comes home, the romance isn't on. There's not that chase. There's no kind of looking in each other's eyes, and you know, do you want to? you know, this or that or this. You know, there's none of that happening because everybody's just out there, you know, satisfying themselves or having affairs or whatever's going on. So, you know, they're not coming together. And the minute the husband gets home, in a lot of relationships, it's like, yeah, look in each other's eyes and there's a bit of flirting and there's, you know, there's that love there because they haven't seen each other all day. And he said, that's not going on. And so therefore, if you are out satisfying yourself or having affairs or whatever, you start having this, you start having complaints against your wife then because you're not drawing close, you're just staying apart. And so you start having complaints and then she has complaints, you have complaints. And that's Satan in there just pulling you further and further and further apart. And I found that really interesting. I thought it's really important to save yourself and to be in that close union, you know, with your husband or with your wife. Because Satan just hates it, doesn't he?
Yes. I was just talking to Phyllis about something that makes women feel powerless a lot of times. And they nag their husbands about doing this or that chore. Or, you know, just complaining about whatever, when a lot of men are very turned off by that and they're actually repelled. It doesn't make it happen. It actually makes it not happen more surely. But what I was pointing out to Phyllis, a case in point was, she wanted to plant this little grouping of iris flowers or plants, and, you know, and she was bringing it up and she brought it up in nice ways. And it wasn't nagging, but she just said, you know, I really do want to do this. And I want to do that. I'd like to do this. And then that's where I'd like to put them. And finally, I decided that I was going to go ahead and help her, you know. But she wasn't putting it all on me. It was, I'd like to do this. I want to do this. So, after a while, you want to do it, you know. Yeah. And Adam had overlooked this little section of grass where he had cut it with the lawnmower, and it was making it difficult for the dog to go to where she wants to go to do her business. So anyway, when she brought it up to him a couple of times, and of course that was not the motivational aspect. See, men need motivation, not nagging. And it, what she did was she said, you know, the dog will go over here and do this where you don't want her to if you don't cut this lower, because all you have to do is just cut this little section and she'll go over here and do that. Well, that did it immediately. You know, within a few hours, that was done.
Analytical.
It's motivation and logic. You've got to use logic on a man. not threaten him or feel powerless. You can outsmart a guy, you know.
Yeah.
You can definitely outsmart people. Not manipulate, but to explain it to him using reasoning. And then the reasoning he understands. Not the emotion and the drama, you know.
Yeah. That's very clever, yeah.
Yeah, you have to be a little bit clever. Because we don't think like women do. They think very emotionally. And they just want things to happen out of sheer will. And emotion gets involved. But we have to have a reason. And when you show us the reason, man, it's done.
That's
now, there's something about marriage that was brought up between the man at the woman at the well and you got John chapter 4. Remember that?
Yeah, that was beautiful.
There's a picture that he opened my mind to that. What was going on? And I noticed that the whole chapter practically was taken up with this conversation between this woman who was a Samaritan. In other words, she was from the northern tribes up north. And Yehuda, of course, he was from Yehuda. And I guess they gave themselves away by their accent and things, but also where they were. But you see, Yehusha was raised up in the north. So his affinity and knowledge of the northerners was no doubt very great. But he sat there at the well and he talked to this woman and asked her to give him a drink. And she was stunned because this was a Jewish person or a Yehudi actually speaking to her. Not only that, but he was speaking to a woman, which was not normally done. You know, a man and a woman. But he asked you know, for the drink. And the woman answered and said, I have no husband. You know, he'd said, bring me your husband, and I'd like to talk to him. And he said, you've said, well, I have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one whom you have now is not your husband. What you have said is true. Now, these many husbands that Yahusha is talking about were literally men, but figuratively, see, there's that literal level, and then there's that figurative level. The many husbands in this teaching, I believe, were the false adulterous affairs of the lost tribes. And the teaching here is that Yahusha is calling back his wife from these dry wells that give the bride, you know, and give his bride eternal life, because he has living water within himself. And the living water is that covenant that he wants to draw her back to, the covenant of marriage, you know. So that was, I don't know if that's even clear yet or not, but it's pretty clear that if we understand the covenant, the Ten Commandments, being the thing that we have as a relationship with Yahuwah, if we break with that covenant, then we have no relationship to him at all, you know. We're without hope.
Yes.
But if you ask the question, what is marriage? We have to start really way back in Genesis or Bereshith chapter 2 and look at verse 18. It says, and Yahuwah Elohim said, it is not good for the man to be alone. I'm going to make a helper for him as his counterpart. And a counterpart can be thought of as a match, a mate, or an opposite part that completes the person, you know. And then continuing, it says, and from the ground Yahuwah Elohim formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called each living creature, that was its name. So the man gave names to all livestock and to the birds of the heavens, and to every beast of the field. But for the man, there was not found a helper. Now, the interesting thing is that word helper is the Hebrew word Ezer, which is in the man's name, Eliezer, the one that went out and found the wife for him as his counterpart. So Yahuwah Elohim caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. And he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh in its place. And the rib which Yahuwah Elohim had taken from the man, he made into a woman. And he brought her to the man. And the man said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. This one is called Isha, because she was taken out of Adam, or the man. Mm-hmm. For this cause, a man shall leave his father and his mother and cleave to his Isha, and they shall become one flesh.
Not cleave to his Ish.
Yeah, you don't want to cleave to your Steve or your John. You want to cleave to your Isha.
Mm-hmm.
Your Isha. An Ish cleaves to an Isha. A man cleaves to a woman, you know. And it doesn't say you cleave to more than one woman, you know.
Mm-hmm.
That's an interesting thing, because in the beginning it was not so. And we were just discussing the beginning. So as it was in the beginning is the way it's supposed to be, ideally, you know.
Yeah.
Now that's going to really rile up a lot of the Nazarene who believe we have to have or should have or can have more than one wife, you know.
Is that, because a lot of the prophets or men of Yahuwah, patriarchs, if you said they had several wives, do you think that was more of a cultural thing? And if so, that was the Hebrew culture. Aren't we trying to get back to that? Or what? How do you kind of express that?
Mm-hmm.
Just something you who are allowed for a little while? Or?
Well, if you consider that and you say, well, what was going on with Abraham? And well, the problem for Abraham began when he took another wife. Obviously, Yahuwah doesn't think that he's not going to throw anybody in the lake of fire because they have two wives. That's not a reason. But there is a problem that started with the second wife, because do you remember Abraham and the Egyptian woman, the servant girl? Actually, Hagar created a big problem, you know. And, of course, yeah. So we have inheritance troubles and, you know, you have a lot of controversy within families. King David or King Daud, Shlomo or Solomon, there's a lot of examples. It was just a man should not multiply and have many, many wives, or neither a king either. But it's just not the example given. It's not the trend. I mean, nobody said, oh, yeah, well, that turned out real well, didn't it? We should shoot for that. You know, it didn't turn out very well.
Yeah.
But you had mentioned the word kupa. You know, in the Jewish tradition, they get under a kupa, which is like a little tent with no walls. And it's usually got four posts. And they get under this. And that represents the household that they're creating. It's just a representation. And it is a tent of sorts. And it is an emblem of a sukkah, really, because at the very end, when Yahushua comes back and we go into the sukkah, it's going to be a marriage, a marriage supper.
Super. That's what tabernacle, is it?
Tabernacle, yeah. Mm. It says in Yahukinen or John chapter 14, in my Father's house are many abodes, and if not, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. He's speaking as a husband. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I shall come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, you might be too. And where I go, you know. And the way, you know. And the way he's speaking of is the covenant. The way is Torah. So we can't tear down our household and say we don't need the covenant. You know, if you I think it's Acts 21. Acts 21 is loaded with all kinds of Luke writing down things that Paul's up to, and one of the things that he mentions in there he's having a meeting with the elders, and they say, "See how many of the Yahudim are very observant of the Torah, you know, and they love it, you know." Mm. So the people that say that they don't love it are wrong. They're believers in Yahushua. Now, as far as the process of getting married, let's take Yishak, or Isaac as they call him, Abraham's son. Eliezer, the servant, finds this woman. And anyway, he didn't go back and take her to Abraham and say, how do you like this for a bride? He didn't get his father's opinion. He just met her, and it was here's what it says in Genesis 24. Starting at verse 63, and Yishak went out to meditate in the field in the evening, and he lifted his eyes and looked up and saw the camels coming. And Ribkah lifted her eyes, and when she saw Yishak, she dismounted from her camel, and she said to the servant, that would be Eliezer, who is this man walking in the field to meet us? And the servant said, it is my master. So she took a veil, that's a burqa, and covered herself. Now that was a cultural thing. And the servant, that's Eliezer, told Yishak all the matters that he had done. In other words, describing the circumstances of how he met her and negotiated with her older brother, being the one that he had to ask, apparently, because the father wasn't there. Because you have to get the some relative's permission, you know, in that culture. And Yishak brought her into his mother Sarah's tent, and he took Ribkah, and she became his wife, and he loved her. Thus, Yishak was comforted after his mother's death. Well, that, there wasn't a ceremony. It's just a matter of joining together, becoming a household. That household is sometimes represented by the tent or the kupa, or it can just be your house, you know, where you live. But if you bring a girl home, you know, and you join with her, you're married to her, you know.
A lot of people who are coming into being a Nazarim are realizing that all you need to do is consummate to be married,
And that's great. They don't go. A lot of them are choosing not to go and have the civil thing done. But a lot of, I've seen a few times on Facebook this week, a few people, there's discussions going on that people who have been Nats are in for a while, and they're only realizing this now, are starting to wonder, oh, well, does that mean our marriage isn't really valid because we only got married by the state and not in Yahuwah's eyes? And I'm just, because we didn't have all these, you know, bells and whistles and all these other things they're saying you have to have, and tents and all sorts of things. And I, at one point, I was just trying to say that you just need to consummate. I'm sure you've all done that. So you're married. Yeah. It's valid. That's what's valid.
You have to act married too, but a lot of times people take and they keep their names intact, and that's not necessarily the way it is, because you know you can take the husband's last name and join it as with a hyphen to your own last name, but that's not really quite it either, because you know when you leave your father's under your father, a woman that leaves his father, her father's residence or tent, household, then she becomes under the authority of her new husband. And one of the symbols of that is to take his name. And that's what we do as servants of Yahusha. We're his bride. Now, if we didn't take his name upon ourselves, then how could we claim that he was our husband? You know, we actually accept his name. And we are called as followers of him, you know, and it's specific. We're not followers of the Lord, because that would be that would be B-A-A-L, you know. We obey only Yahuwah. But, you know, it is a voluntary thing, and it was voluntary then, too. I mean, even if a woman was decided, a lot of times they were arranged marriages, and that's good, because the older people were looked upon with great respect, and they knew what was best for their children, and the bride and the son that was going to marry the bride would always respect their parents, both parents, decision for them to be married. A lot of times it would be uniting two households together in their fortunes, because they would say, well, this is going to make the offspring more secure. But to just marry some a woman of means, to marry a man that didn't have a means, well, that's okay, but it was usually outside the parameters of what they did. But the woman still had the ability to say no. Mm. You know, back in Genesis 24, earlier in the chapter, the example is given, you know, because the wife, the woman, Rivka, had the opportunity to say no. Mm. But
we've fallen short a lot, haven't we, in all these things?
Really, yeah. So it's not against her will, but in the Latin we have the word raptus or raptus, and the Greek word for that is harpazo, and it means to seize or to catch or take away. And of course the equivalent Hebrew word is dabak, and it means to grab, to seize, but not or lakak, L-A-C-A-C-H or L-A-Q-A-C-H. That's Hebrew word 39:47. But the thing of it is, the commandment to not adulterate, which is number 7, I believe, you shall not break wedlock. That's just two Hebrew words. Lo, which means no, lakach, L-A-Q-A-C-H. Hmm. Just two words, you know. Hmm. Yeah. A lot of, some of the commandments just involve two words, you know. Mm. But the idea that you were talking about of having a ceremony or whatever, that's fine. They had parties. They had, you know, wedding supper type thing, and then they went on and had a wedding celebration that went on for days in some cases. Mm. And friends and relatives would be invited from faraway places, and they come. That's why it would last for days, because people had come a long way, you know, and they were just there to rejoice over the union. But prior to 325 CE, Christians didn't really practice any kind of ceremony at all. It was something that they adopted, apparently, as a practice, you know. But a marriage began with a ceremony in the Roman culture, but the Christians didn't practice it, you know, as we understand Christians. Whatever Christians were, we call them that, but, you know, the thing of it is a lot of them were not really labeled that. They were actually called Nazarene, you know. Anyway, the Roman procedure started out with a ceremony, and it was called conventio in manum, and it ended in a ceremony as well. So they had a breaking union, so they could divorce, you know. Well. But so anyway, they when the first step was to get permission. Well, he gave the woman a gift first. That was the first thing he did. So Abraham's eldest servant, Eliezer, when he met Rivka, what happened in Genesis 24, verse 47 was, I asked her and said, whose daughter are you? And she said, the daughter of Bethuel, Nahor's son, whom Milcah bore to him. Then I put the nose ring on her nose and the bracelets on her wrists. Now that's a nose ring and a bracelet, which were gifts that she was going to be able to keep, you know. And obviously it was a symbol of the giver having great wealth. And it was probably astoundingly beautiful. You know, these weren't just chunks of metal. And so anyway, the next thing that he had was go to the family and, if there was a father, find out if he could get permission for her to become a bride, a wife, or in that case, they had to ask the older brother. But anyway, the custom of wearing rings, though, you notice it was a nose ring and a bracelet, but it wasn't a ring for a finger. That custom comes from pagans. And a lot of people that wear wedding rings are doing something that actually relates to the Roman deity of love and fertility, Venus. And the third finger of the left hand was believed to have a vein in it, which it does. Actually, they all do. And it was believed that it went all the way to the heart. Imagine that. Veins connected to the heart. Wow. Well, they all are. But anyway, the ring in marriage on the left hand honored this deity, Venus. And rings were not worn by husbands at all until the 20th century.
20th century, wow.
And, of course, we think it's something completely normal.
So, yeah, we're brought up to believe that, that wedding rings are cool, but if you start piercing your nose and sticking things in your nose, that's a bit tribal, that's a bit pagan. Would you class the nose rings and earrings and things like that as pagan or just...
No.
Useless jewelry.
Now, if somebody wants to, well, there's a lot of people today that are tattooing themselves, they're even branding themselves, and they're, you know, putting all sorts of metal through all kinds of places in skin. But the nose ring and the earrings, those are old customs that have been around a long time. But I wouldn't require my wife to have a nose ring because it's just not something that's culturally adopted by us, you know. But, of course, the younger generation, they're going to think, yeah, that's happening. And but it doesn't really have any symbolism in it at all, you know.
But if your wife wanted one, you wouldn't be saying it's pagan. It's not pagan.
No, no, if she wanted a nose ring, you know.
There you go, Phyllis.
Yeah, but it would be something she would do, I'm sure. But, anyway, the pagan custom of throwing rice at a wedding, you know, people that do that, it symbolized semen, and it was believed to ensure fertility. Yeah. Well, that's kind of pagan practice, you know. It's simply monstrous.
Yeah.
Anyway.
So what else in the wedding ceremony, pick that apart a little bit. So the rings are pagan. If you want to have a kupah, that's cool. If you don't, fine. What about the white dress? Is that something that's neither here nor there? Or
no, it's not. Doesn't matter. The symbolism of the white dress is purity, of course, but you know, and but it's not necessary. But you know, he wants, when Yahuwah is trying to get his tribes back from the nations, and he's trying to get them to listen to him from where they are. And here we are, I'm in North America, you're in Australia, and of course we're on opposite sides of the earth, as are many of the Nazarene that are coming back to the covenant, and we're realizing who we are, and that he's calling us back to his heart and his mind, and he's searching out our hearts and minds, and he knows that we're willing servants and we want to obey him, and all we have to do is just meditate on his Torah day and night, speak of it in our house, and when we rise up and when we lie down, and so forth. And sometimes when I'm driving, I'll just start reciting the Ten Commandments just from memory as I'm driving along. You know, what better? That's a form of prayer too, because you're in union with him when you're doing that. Because you can't not think about him. You know, it's like a bride thinking about her husband that is gone away, you know. And the Song of Solomon is a song. The Song of Solomon is something that is loaded with Yahuwah's love for his bride, you know. I gave you a little text of that in an email, remember?
That's right.
Where is your beloved? Where is your beloved God? You know, and we yearn for him to come back.
We do.
But anyway, it's interesting, though, if you look at Yeshayahu or Isaiah 49, if you go from verse 1 through verse 26, you see that he's in the midst of all of it. He's saying, "Shall it be a small matter for you to be my servant, to raise up the tribes of Yaakov?" That would be Jacob, and to bring back the preserved ones of Israel. He's talking about Yahusha being spiritually bringing back the preserved ones. And he says, "I shall give you as a light to the Gentiles, to be my deliverance to the ends of the earth." And man, here we are. We're on at the ends of the earth. You know, New Zealand, Australia, the Philippines, we're all over the place, the Isles of the Sea, and he's brought us back to his covenant. He's quickened our hearts and our minds. And he said, "In a favorable time, I shall answer you, and in the day of deliverance, I shall help you, and I guard you, and give you for a covenant to the people, to restore the earth, to cause them to inherit the ruined inheritances, and to say to the prisoners, go out. To those who are in the darkness, show yourselves. Let them feed on the ways, and let your pasture be on all bare hills." Anyway, he's guiding us through these, you know, all these places that we are. And it says, "See these come from far away, and see those from the north and the west, and these from the land of Shinnim. Sing, O heavens, rejoice, O earth, and break out in singing, O mountains. For Yahuwah shall comfort his people and have compassion on his afflicted ones." But Sion says, "Yahuwah has forsaken me, and Yahuwah has forgotten me." Sion is a code word for his bride. "Would a woman forget her nursing child and not have compassion on the son of her womb? Though they forget, I will never forget you. See, I have inscribed you on the palms of my hands. Your walls are ever before me. Your sons shall hurry, and your destroyers, and those who laid you waste, depart from you. Lift up your eyes around and see. All of them gather together and come to you. As I live, declares Yahuwah, you shall put on all of them as an ornament, and bind them on you as a bride does." That's very interesting. He's talking to us, you know. See, we're saying she's forsaken us. But then he says, I've inscribed you on the palms of my hands. And we know he has, you know.
Yeah.
Because that's who he died for.
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah, the price of this bride was Yahusha's life, you know?
Hmm.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
His love held him on that wood. It wasn't anything else.
Yeah.
But look at frame 29. I think we're slide 29. It says, "Yet thus said Yahuwah, even the captives of the mighty is taken away, and the prey of the ruthless is delivered. And I strive with them who strives with you, and I save your children. And I shall feed those who oppress you with their own flesh, and let them drink their own blood as sweet wine. All flesh shall know that I, Yahuwah, am your Savior, and your Redeemer, the Elohim of Yaakov." So we know who our husband is, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. And it says here in Yeshayahu 54, verse 5, "For your maker is your husband. Yahuwah of hosts is his name. And the set-apart one of Israel is your redeemer. He is called the Elohim of all the earth." There's no doubt who our husband is. But he talks about an everlasting love in Yirmiyahu or Jeremiah 31. The everlasting love is so amazing to hear from his own mind. He says in Jeremiah 31:3, it says, "Yahuwah appeared to me from afar, saying, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore I shall draw you with kindness. I am going to build you again, and you shall be rebuilt, O maiden of Yisrael. Again you shall take up your tambourines and go forth in the dances of those who rejoice. Again you shall plant vines on the mountains of Shomeron. The planters shall plant and treat them as common. For there shall be a day when the watchmen cry on Mount Ephraim, arise and let us go up to Sion, to Yahuwah our Elohim. For thus said Yahuwah, sing with gladness for Yaakov, and shout among the chief of the nations. Cry out, give praise, and say, O Yahuwah, save your people, the remnant of Israel." It's awesome. And then he says, "See, I'm bringing them from the land of the north and shall gather them from the ends of the earth. Among them, the blind and the lame, those with child and those in labor, together a great assembly, returning here. With weeping they shall come. And with their prayers I bring them. I shall make them walk by rivers of waters, in a straight way in which they do not stumble. For I shall be a father to Israel and Ephraim. He is my firstborn. Hear the word of Yahuwah, O Gentiles, and declare it in the isles afar off, and say, He who scattered Israel gathers him, and shall guard him as a shepherd his flock. For Yahuwah shall ransom Yaakov, and redeem him from the hand of one stronger than he." Anyway, that's all part of our deliverance that's coming.
Yeah.
Anyway, this is really interesting. I had a couple of quotes that I had from some people that are contemporary living people today. This is from the United States Supreme Court, and this is the Supreme Court of the land. This is a quote: "Marriage has more to do with the morals and civilization of a people than any other institution." That's an interesting thing coming from a Supreme Court. Mm-hmm. And then a Senator, Kay Bailey Hutchison, she said, quote, "We need to protect traditional marriage." And they're fighting against it all the time. "We should not allow some states to impose their definition of marriage on other states." And former President George W. Bush said, "Marriage is a sacred institution between a man and a woman." Mm-hmm. Now, another person that was really insightful about all the problems that society's having all over the world, really, is Maggie Gallagher. She said, quote, "When men and women fail to form stable marriages, the result is a vast expansion of government attempts to cope with the terrible social needs that result. There is scarcely a dollar that the state and federal government spends on social programs that is not driven in large part by family fragmentation. Crime, poverty, drug abuse, teen pregnancy, school failure, mental and physical health problems, unquote. And that's so true.
That's happening.
Yeah. And as far as on the level between Yehuda and Israel being divorced, because the 10 tribes didn't obey the covenant, they were carried away into the nations, and they've never been brought back. They've been dispersed, and they literally became the nations. And it's recorded for us here in Jeremiah or Yirmiyahu 3. It says, Elohim said, if a man puts away his wife, and she goes from him and becomes another man's, does he return to her again? And that's what you were talking about. How can he remarry? Would not the land be made greatly unclean? But you have committed whoring with many lovers. See that connection that I made with the woman at the well? And she had five husbands, and the one that she was with? He's saying it right there. Now, it says, but you have committed whoring with many lovers, and would you return to me, declares Yahuwah. Lift up your eyes to the bare heights and see, where have you not lain with men? Besides the ways that you have sat for them like an Arabian in the wilderness, and you have made the land unclean with your whorings and your evil. And Yahuwah said to me in the days of Yoshiyah, the sovereign, have you seen what backsliding Israel has done? She has gone up on every high mountain and under every green tree, and there committed whoring. In other words, they were worshiping the A-S-H-E-R-A-I-M, and they were, you know, worshiping other deities. And after she had done all these, I said, return to me. But she did not return. And her treacherous sister, Yehuda, saw it. That's the southern tribes. And I saw that for all the causes for which backsliding Israel had committed adultery, I had put her away and given her a certificate of divorce. Yet her treacherous sister, Yehuda, did not fear, but went on, committed whoring too. And it came to be, through her frivolous whoring, that she defiled the land and committed adultery with stones and wood. And yet for all this, her treacherous sister, Yehuda, has not returned to me with all her heart, but falsely. And Yehuda said to me, backsliding Yisrael has shown herself more righteous than treacherous Yehuda. Go and proclaim these words toward the north and say, return, O backsliding Yisrael, declares Yehuda. I shall not look upon you in displeasure, for I am kind, declares Yehuda, and I do not bear a grudge forever. Only acknowledge your crookedness, because you have transgressed against Yahuwah your Elohim, and have scattered your ways to strangers under every green tree, and you have not obeyed my voice, declares Yahuwah. Return, O backsliding children, declares Yahuwah, for I shall rule over you, and shall take you, one from a city and two from a clan, and shall bring you to Sion. See, it's like he's talking to that woman at the well, you know. And I shall give over, and I shall give you shepherds according to my heart, and they shall feed you with knowledge and understanding. And it shall be when you have increased and shall bear fruit in the land in those days, declares Yahuwah, that they no longer say, the ark of the covenant of Yahuwah, neither would it come to heart, nor would they remember it, nor would they visit it, nor would it be made again. At that time, Jerusalem shall be called the throne of Yahuwah, and all the nations shall be gathered to it to the name of Yahuwah, Jerusalem, and no longer walk after the stubbornness of their evil heart. In those days the house of Yehuda shall go to the house of Yisrael, and they shall come together out of the land of the north to the land that I have given as an inheritance to your father.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Oh, isn't it?
Anyway, he always talks about Yisrael being one stick, if you read Ezekiel 37. And he says, but he continues in the text that we were just looking at, He says, how would I put you among the children and give you a pleasant land, a splendid inheritance of the hosts of nations? And I said, call me my father, and do not turn away from me. But indeed, as a wife betrays her husband, so have you betrayed me, O house of Israel, declares Yahuwah. A voice was heard on the bare heights, weeping supplications of the children of Israel, because they have perverted their way. They have forgotten Yahuwah their Elohim. Return, O backsliding children. I shall make your backsliding cease. See, we have come to you, for you are Yahuwah, our Elohim. That's what we're saying. We're coming back, you know. It's wonderful.
Hallelujah.
So the restoration is all about us re-enjoining to the covenant, and we're realizing that, and you know, this battle we see in the court system and all over about the Ten Commandments and classrooms and all that. This restoration can't occur unless we enjoin to the covenant, you know. Our family believes that the government has nothing to say about marriage any more than breathing air, because they can puff up and beat their chest all they want about what they declare about marriage, but it doesn't amount to a hill of beans, because that's outside their purview. They have no ability to make a person married or to break a marriage up. They really don't. That civil authority, so-called civil authority that they think they have, is just imaginary. That's like saying the Catholics have sacraments that are real. They're not real. They're just believed in. You know, and marriage is not a sacrament. You can strain all you want to say it is, but it isn't. It's a contract or a covenant between a man and a woman. Now, where's the government involved exactly? I don't hear that. Okay. Bye-bye then. There is no involvement. There's not. I mean, even we as Nazarene corporately, we can't say that we bring anybody together or take them apart, because it's only Yahuwah that brings a person together. He is the authority. So if we usurp that, and we even imagine that, say, somebody in between the man and the woman is not Yahuwah, but somebody else. See, we're actually, in some way, usurping his authority out of the equation, and we're inserting someone else, another authority. You know, that's what I'm saying, you know. Because we don't have any, what they call, ecclesiastical power to do anything, you know, about marriage. Or am I left field? I don't see where, you know, can interfere. If a man and a woman decide that they're going to covenant with one another and join, and that union is not looked upon favorably by anybody, an entire nation, the United Nations can say, no, it doesn't matter, because they're still married. They can all deny it and say, no, they're not married. Yeah, they are too, because Yahuwah brings people together. So we have to kind of get over ourselves, you know, and not be judgmental.
So if you did all that before you became Nazarene, and you had a pope or a pastor or somebody in between it marrying you, or other people that are worried, when you come into being a Nazarene, you don't go and have to do it all again. You just pick up where you are, and all that's washed away anyway, all your past madness, and you go on. You don't part from your wife or have to get married again or anything like that, do you?
Oh, no. There was examples given where Paul writes about men and women. One would become a believer in the Messiah while the other one would not, and he gave real good advice to the one that was a believer to say that that's not a reason to leave. That's actually a reason to stay and show the Messiah's love for them, you know, without beating them over the head with it, but being loving, because we're not called to be mean-spirited, you know, or judgmental. See, if we start becoming judges and enforcers, then we're outside of our boundaries too. We've left the, what do they call it? Left the rails. We've gone off the rails.
Off the rails, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. But the restoration is the marriage to Yahuwah. And that's what we're all about. You know, we're looking for sons and daughters to add, to bring to the wedding feast. And that's an interesting thing, because when we actually are successful at bringing someone to whatever it is we're bringing them to, the faith or whatever, he's given us the examples in his own word about the thing that's happening is we're going out and becoming hunters, and we're looking under rocks and in the hills, and we're digging people out, because a lot of people that were invited to the wedding supper are saying, well, not yet. I'm not really going yet. I'm going to have to go take care of something that's more important to me. Well, if we can go out and hunt down people that will listen and they become invited, then they're going to a wedding supper, you know, the wedding feast, and they will become the bride. So, wow, that's going to be an amazing thing. And it is a wedding. And they will partake of that wedding with us, you know. And I don't care how long I have to work and somebody else doesn't have to work. I'm interested in gathering more people to the feast. And I'll get the same pay as somebody that worked 1 hour. It doesn't matter. Mm. You know.
Yeah.
But.
So important, isn't it?
Yes, it is. The prodigal son, that's Luke 15, that's all about this too, you know. The older brother was real disturbed over it, but he shouldn't be, you know.
Well, he's going to be jealous, isn't he? Because we're coming back with a zeal and a joy, and often a lot of them don't have that. Not that we should be disrespectful, but just understand that they've been slaving away for years, and who are we to come back and declare that we're the bride?
Yeah. Well, one of these days, it's going to be all over, and the trap is going to close, and he's going to come back. The cry is going to go out, you know. And he gives an example of that in Matthew 25. Just look at starting at verse 5. Now, while the bridegroom took time, see, we're talking about a husband again, they all slumbered and slept. Now, who's sleeping is the 10 virgins, as they call it. There's 5 wise virgins and 5 unwise virgins. So there's a total of 10 virgins. It says they all slumbered and slept, and at midnight a cry was heard. See, the bridegroom is coming. Go out to meet him. Then all those maidens rose up and trimmed their lamps, and the foolish said to the wise, give us of your oil, because our lamps are going out. And that's interesting, because it's going to happen just like that, and people are going to be either prepared and know what's happening and be ready, or they're not, you know.
Yeah. And that parable there was a big eye-opener for me, because for years we thought that the wise were true believers and the foolish were just in the world. They, you know, there was a big distinction, but we're starting to understand now that the wise and the foolish, he's not talking to... Most of the time he's not talking to the world, because the world's not interested in him. The world's not even part of his plan unless they graft in. Right. He's talking to believers, isn't he? Half of them are wise and half are foolish.
Yes.
Mm.
Yeah. Some of them are living in a religion, and some of them are living in a reality. And the ones that are wise are actually feeding the household. They're actively doing that. That's what they pant to do. We're out of breath every morning when we come out. We wake up and we go, thank you for one more day to be able to find someone. And almost every day at that shop, I have somebody that I meet. Some days more than one, some days two or three. But there was a girl that had been shopping there for years, and she just went off on something as she was being checked out, and I said, well, you know, there is a book about that sort of thing that I could probably, you'd probably be very interested in. And I showed her a copy of FC10, and she said, this is great. This is exactly what I've been looking for. And I told her that I had written the book, and she said, what? I've been coming in here for years. I had no, she'd seen me, you know, but she never knew, you know. Mm-hmm. It's just a matter of people are ready at a certain point, and Yahuwah slips in and says, she's ready now. you know, or he's ready now, and he opens your mouth, and they're ready. But, yeah. Now, if you want to know about divorce, Yahuwah hates divorce, so don't go there. Usually it's based on selfishness, you know, and those ultimatums and trying to manipulate each other. Come on. But Malachi 2, verses 14 through 16, two verses. Yet you say, why? Because Yahuwah has been witness between you and the wife of your youth, against whom you have dealt treacherously. Yet she is your companion and the wife of your covenant. And did he not make one? And he had the remnant of the Spirit? And it says, and what is the one alone? He seeks a seed of Elohim. Therefore, take heed to your spirit, and let none deal treacherously against the wife of his youth. For I hate divorce, said Yahuwah Elohim of Israel. And the one who covers his garment with cruelty, and you, said Yahuwah of hosts. So you shall guard your spirit, and do not act treacherously. So we shouldn't act treacherously toward one another, either. Even when we're dealt with treacherously, we return that with kindness and understanding and try to be deferent and considerate of the other person, you know, that's losing it. They're usually losing it because they're struggling or they're wrestling. I see people all the time that are at different stages of development, and they're wrestling, and they come across as being hateful or judgmental, and they seem to be attacking you or your what you're saying, but really it's they're struggling with it, and they're pleading for you to come up with something that'll convince them, you know, and that's really what that is.
I wrestle
with them, but I just let them just there you go wrestle all you want until you get it. And it, sometimes we can take it personally, but you don't take anything personally, because you know they're wrestling. Yeah.
That's been a hard thing for me to face. I've had a few big eye-openers this week because you tend to, and particularly as a young person, have an opinion about yourself that you're at a certain level. And talking to believers who have been Nazarene for a lot longer, whether they're younger or older than me, you tend to put yourself in a sort of place down here, which as far as humility is concerned is the right way to go, but an unhealthy down here sort of, oh, I wish I could get up to the big boys table, that sort of thing, and trying to compete in the knowledge and trying to have these scholastic conversations. And what you're saying is really making sense to me because it's all about love. And I've had to wake up a lot this week, and I've had lots of conversations with lots of people, and realizing that this love that I think everybody's got, and that I'm not really there yet, and I, because of the words they're saying and the, you know, wonderful Hebrew that sprouts out of their mouth and all these things that I can't do. And I'm starting to wake up to the fact that a lot of these people are addicted to knowledge and they're in the knowledge, but I'm not feeling the love. Like when we talk, I don't feel like you're putting me down at all. I don't feel like you're trying to tell me you're not good enough, Mark, or anything like that. But a lot of believers, I think, I haven't understood. You've been saying love, 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 love ever since I've met you, brother, but I don't think until I've sort of started having more experiences I've understood what that means. A lot of people don't have it. They don't have his love. They're not expressing his love as the most important thing above anything else. It's really been an eye-opener this week for me to realize that I have his love. And I'm still growing to express it more and more, but I have his love, and I don't know a lot of the things that a lot of the other people know, but so what?
Yeah.
You know, I'm happy to be taught, but
oh, yeah.
A lot of people at the can't, end of the, a lot at of the people end of the can't day, be taught.
Yeah. At the end of the day, at the end of your life, however long it may be, when you're lying there and you're taking your last few breaths, you're not going to be thinking, wow, I wish I'd have learned a lot more Latin or a lot more Hebrew. But you see, it's the love that you learned, and that's what matters, and that you know him, and that he will recognize you. But to be cast out because you failed, because you didn't love, that's got to be the worst. I could always show off and speak to you in Latin. I had to do that. I have all sorts of Latin prayers memorized that I can't get out of my head. But I've got a lot more Hebrew. But, you know, Hebrew prayers. But we're speaking the language right now, the babbling lips. He said that we would speak to one another in babbling lips. And that's what we're doing. To him, Hebrew is not babbling. But we are restoring the name and the proper terms, avoiding the pagan stuff. So that's not that difficult. It's still in there. You know, everybody has that because, you know, and we stumble with that. But you're absolutely right, though. Yeah. If we pursue knowledge, then we're not making the right choice there, you know. I mean, we can't pick up, you know, that as a sign. It's like a lot of people wear it as a badge of honor, you know, either in outward appearance or what they wear, a hat or, you know, a prayer shawl or whatever. That's external. Externals don't matter at all, you know. Yeah. But
yeah, I really appreciate that. Really appreciate that you don't show off to me in Hebrew and talk to me in Hebrew. It's like going to a party and everybody's speaking a language and you're standing there going, "Oh yeah," and they start pointing at you and talking, and you go, "What are they saying about me?"
Yeah. Well, the fastest talkers that I've found on the planet are lovely people. They're actually Hebrews. They a lot of them don't know it, but it's the Spanish people. Oh. You know, all the people that are Mexican, Spanish, South American, people that speak Espanol, they're actually, you know, all the tribes mixed up. You know, they're like, you know, where Yona was going to Tarshish in southern Spain, you know, one of the colonies. And, of course, Brazil, that was a colony too, you know. And we've talked about Brazil being the word in Hebrew for iron. But, you know, we do, I etymologically study Hebrew. I look for words that are, because the words are like little jewel boxes, and you can open them up and there's treasure inside because they have meanings. You know, names have meanings, and words have meanings. I love to study the Hebrew language because it's a source of tens of thousands of English words, you know.
Yeah.
But anyway, we talked about him hating divorce.
Yeah.
So
if there has been fornication, or if there has been adultery, that by scripture is a reason that you are allowed to get divorced. But in that sort of circumstance, you would probably encourage them to try and work it out, wouldn't you? Because Yahusha hates divorce.
Yeah, first and foremost, I would encourage a reconciliation and a recommitment to one another. Doesn't have to be done, you know, in a ceremony. I'm just talking about, in fact, no ceremony is even necessary. But the fact is, if you open a checking account and you take the husband's name, and you find a way to get some bills paid with that name, then you have created a household. And by the two of you creating the household, you don't need external help to do that. So you actually create your own household by, you know, the joining together. Now, the idea of if there's fornication or adultery or whatever by one of the two people, and the person you know, admits that they were weak and they fell, and then they say, well, I made a mistake, and I'm going to do something about it. I'm going to change my ways. And the other partner is willing to keep them and accept them in spite of that. Then that other partner is being more like Yahuwah than they realize, because that's exactly what Yahuwah is like. He'll take that you know, fornicating or adulterous bride right back, because he, you know, he's a forgiving, kind creator. And, you know, some of us have come from various backgrounds. Some of us have come from Catholicism or some derivative of that through Baptists or Lutherans or Presbyterians or all these denominations, Pentecostals, and learned all these different patterns. And some people have actually been raised in Wicca, you know.
Mm.
You know, a lot of these people who are from secular households got drawn into that. In the world today, there's a lot of people that are being drawn away into spell casting and learning how to... Well, they're taken under the wings of a witch, and the witch teaches them. And they go out looking for tarot cards. Like, they walk in my shop and they... Do you all have tarot cards? As I've brought up before. But see, no, that's against Deuteronomy 18. You should read Deuteronomy 18.
Yeah.
And then they go, what? You know, but...
Spooky.
It's great.
Yeah.
But, you know, I said, those tarot cards aren't going to help
you.
No. You know, I said, you know, I was talking to a lady the other day. And I said, you know, this stuff is real, you know. But... just because it's real doesn't mean it's right.
Yeah. So dealing with divorce and adultery and fornication and things, do you, I mean, we don't have to go into it, but do you consider fornication to simply be with somebody else? Does fornication, can you be fornicating with yourself? Do you believe that? Does that come under the concept of fornication?
Well, in the mind it can be, yeah. If you're addicted to... pornography, then you would be fornicating. Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah, that would be something that would cause, you know, you're not doing the right thing. It's just not proper use.
Mm.
I view that as something that you probably want to avoid, because Yahuwah didn't create us to have sex with ourselves.
Yeah.
You know, that's improper use. But he would rather have us do things and function as he created us to function as.
Mm.
But
yeah,
fornication can be just thoughts.
Mm.
Or dwelling on someone that you might see. Mm. And imagining things, you know. Mm. That's fornication. That's adultery or fornication in your heart. In your mind. And sin starts in the heart. So if your heart is dwelling on something, then immediately what you need to do to overcome that is to flash to Yahusha and put him back in charge of your mind. Because obviously you've pushed him out of the way. He's very, very easily pushed out of the way, because he will not be controlling of you. He wants you to allow him to control you. And so instantly he will give you the power. And we're supposed to flee sexual sins and things like that, because he knows that we're weak in that area, especially when we're in our youth. The drive is so strong. The best thing to do is just flee, you know, physically.
Yeah,
just give it away from it.
Yeah.
You know, run away. And I don't mean walk away.
Run.
I mean,
yeah.
Yeah. And because, you know, the road that path goes down, and that includes adulterous affairs too. If you see yourself flirting with a coworker or someone that you're spending time with, then you need to stop spending time with them.
Yeah.
Stop and
giving people the wrong idea.
Tell them that we don't want the wrong idea to go on here. This is not the right, I'm not the right person for that. You know, just tell them. Say we're friends. You know, that's it. You know.
There shouldn't be a gray area, should there? There shouldn't be confusion, because Satan is the author of confusion.
Yeah.
So you got to take the scripture as the scripture says, and not, you know, instead of reading into it too much.
Yeah, and we should remember who we live for. First and foremost, we live for Yahuwah, and we're doing his will or we're not. And we have to keep on that task every day and every minute of every day, every second. And then we also, if we're married and committed to our partner, we have to remember that we're living for them. And when they're living for you and you're living for them, you can't have anything but a good outcome. Mm-hmm. You know? And, you know, some days your spouse is feeling down, maybe physically, maybe mentally. There's depression, there's this and there's that. There's all kinds of hormones. And sometimes, a lot of times, women have a lot of up and down stuff going on, you know, less so than men. I mean, more so than men. Men are a little bit more even, but we're weak too sometimes. But if we see the other one having some trouble, feeling a little bit, you know, tired, as some of us who are overworked can easily do, we need the other one to lean on, you know, but don't take advantage of it too much, you know.
Yeah.
Don't manipulate and don't lay ultimatums on them, you know. That's a bad thing to do.
Mm. So a lot of us younger people would look, and I have a few friends that are older and they can confirm it too, that the feelings and emotions and drives that a man and a woman have in a marriage for a husband and a wife, they don't stop as you get older, do they, brother? You're still living and loving and, you know, wanting each other, aren't you?
Oh, yeah.
So young people should not think that you somehow just go cold. Because young people have some really weird views of old people. You know, they think, oh, they wouldn't know what we're going through. How can they not?
Yeah, they've been there.
Where did you come from? You know?
That's right.
Yeah.
The old people are the people who know all about everything that they're going through. Mm. And it's good to go to them and get advice. If you're having a problem, go to somebody. But don't ask them the question, should I get divorced or should I stay? That's the wrong one to ask. Unless they're someone who is guided by Torah.
Mm.
Because, you see, if you have marital problems, you know, the first person that you should go to is Yahusha. He's the one that brought you together. And he has the solution as to how to fix the problem. And then you should go to the mate, your spouse, and say, I want to recommit myself to you. I've been just expecting lately. My mind's just been going in another direction, apparently. But I haven't been focused on you. And you're the most important thing in my life, next to Yahusha. And I need to take time and, you know, redevelop that relationship. Because that's what you were saying earlier this morning. You were saying that it was a matter of people just going home. You should hug your spouse when you leave for work, and you should hug your spouse when you come home from work. And I mean hold them, really hold them, so that you remember it all day. And then your arrival back home together, you're back, because your home is your spouse, you know. It doesn't matter whether you're driving around in a caravan or not. That's your home, because you're with your spouse, you know. I've always told Phyllis that. I said, no matter where we go, if we're out taking care of an errand, going to the post office with a big shipment to send around the world, I've told her, you know, I'm home right then, because she's my home. And I'm her home. And we tell each other that, you know. And I'm really glad, because at least we know who our home is, you know. But our real home, of course, is not here. We're going to be with Yahusha, and he's prepared a place for us. Anyway, talking about what a person who's, let's say, having an affair, it says in 1 Corinthians 7, starting at verse 10, and to the married, I command, not I, but the master, a wife should not separate from a husband. But if she is indeed separated, let her remain unmarried or be restored to favor with her husband. And let a husband not send away a wife. And to the rest I say, but not the master, if any brother has an unbelieving wife and she thinks it well to live with him, let him not send her away you know. And a woman who has an unbelieving husband, and he thinks it well to live with her, let her not send him away. For the unbelieving husband has been set apart in the wife, and the unbelieving wife has been set apart in the husband. Otherwise, your children would be unclean. But now they are set apart. The children are set apart. And if the unbelieving one separates, let him separate himself. A brother or a sister has not been enslaved in such matters, but Elohim has called us to peace. That's wonderful. Yes. And then later on in that, it says a wife is bound by Torah as long as her husband lives. And if her husband dies, she is free to be married to whom she desires, but only in the master. In other words, that is, she can only remarry within the faith. But she is better off if she remains as she is, according to my opinion. And I think I also have the spirit of Elohim. That's interesting that Paul would say that. I think I also have the spirit of Elohim. But that's his opinion, of course, that if she does get married, you know. That's Paul, though. But the story ends, the story, that would be the history of the world, does end with marriage. So, you know. And it's interesting because let's read Revelation 19, starting at verse 5. And a voice came from the throne saying, "Praise our Elohim, all you his servants, and those who fear him, both small and great." And I heard as the voice of a great crowd, as the sound of many waters, and as the sound of mighty thunder, saying, "Hallelujah, for Yahuwah El Shaddai reigns. Let us be glad and rejoice and give him praise, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife prepared herself. And to her it was given to be dressed in fine linen, clean and bright, for the fine linen is the righteousnesses of the set apart ones. And he said to me, write, blessed are those who have been called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true words of Elohim." And that's so true. Not everybody's going to be there. So notice the order of events. There's a certain event that happened. And Matthew 13, starting at verse 41, the Son of Adam shall send down his messengers. Now those are the reapers. And they shall gather out of his reign all the stumbling blocks and those doing lawlessness, and shall throw them into the furnace of fire. There shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous shall shine forth as the sun in the reign of their Father. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Again, the reign of the heavens is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man, having found it, hid, and for joy over it, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the reign of the heavens is like a man, a merchant, seeking fine pearls, who, when he had found one pearl of great price, went and sold all he had and bought it. And, of course, it's interesting, but the treasure in that field, the field is the world, and the treasure is actually Yahuwah's own inheritance, which is Israel. And he sowed Israel into the world, and that it, he buried it, he hid it, and he found it, and he sold all he had. In other words, he gave his life, you know, because of his great love for that treasure that was in the field. And he's hunted us down by to the very person. Every man, every woman that he's seeking, he's knocking and saying, "Please let me in." And if we don't, we'll perish. But if we don't let him in to our heart, then we're all going to perish. And that's what we're appealing, you know, because you know, he wants us so badly to accept his sacrifice and his life, you know.
And he's very jealous, isn't he? He's always trying to get our attention.
Yes. Yeah. He certainly is. Yeah. And he's really going to get the Earth's attention when he closes the trap. Yeah. And we've done all that we can do. Mm. You know, a lot of people think it's over when we die. And to an extent, that's probably true. There's some things that we don't know yet, though. Because, see, he can speak to those that are in the grave. We can't. We're not supernatural in our ability. He is. So he can speak to the dead. But let's not count on that. Let's assume that we're going to have to do a certain amount of work here while we're in our flesh. And we're going to actually receive rewards for what we have done in our flesh. Mm. And by the words that we speak, every single word that we speak that is either building up or tearing down. And that's why I'm so concerned about the people that are tearing down. Because if we're working against one another, then what is he going to say about that? You know, we have to be very careful with our words and be very patient with the other members of the body, you know.
Yeah. And tears have been sown among us.
Yes.
But we have to be loving them.
Yeah, that explanation that you and Chris came up with was wonderful. You want to share a little bit of that?
Well, I touched on a little bit before. I thought the parable of the virgins, one was wise and one, I thought it was part of in the world. That's what religion's taught, Christianity's taught. You know, you're great and they're wrong. But we're realizing now that the rain, it's all about the rain. And so he's talking about the rain of the heavens is like this and like that and like this and like that. The rain was the good seed sown. The rain is in men and women's hearts. So the tares are also sown there as well. So half of Messianics or Nazarene are wise and half of them are foolish. Half of them are wheat, half of them are tares. That's what we realize. And so when I'm talking to people all the time, I often get deceived. I'm just trying to have a nice time and I don't like thinking bad thoughts about people, so I'm just trying to keep the peace and everything. And no matter what they might be doing to me, and so it's been coming to my attention a lot this week. Look, wake up. You know, you've got to be more cluey, like not to be hateful, but just to enable you to love better. You have to face what the other people are doing, what another person is doing to you in order to be able to consciously love them, not just to get sucked into a mindset or, you know, be deceived. So where it says, so many places it says, do not be deceived. And so I've often thought with brothers and sisters, oh yeah, I can unbuckle my armor a bit and take it off and let's just relax. And you don't realize that a lot of brothers and sisters aren't at that place. Sometimes there's a knife and we've got to have our armor and we've got to love. So it's been a big week for me, just emotionally, just facing things about myself and what I'm doing. And it's, but as far as this message is concerned, we realize that the Darnell was sown into the Messianic or into the Nazarene. It's been sown into the rain, and in the end, he'll pull it out of the rain, like he says, and throw it in the fire. And that's what we realized. Wake up, brothers and sisters, and face what's in front of you day to day, so that you then are able to love it more effectively and not just think it's you. A lot of the time, spirits are trying to tell you it's you. Look, you're this and you're that and you're wrong, and you know, you didn't handle that very well. And you know, look what they're saying about you. Maybe it's true. A lot of the time it's not. You know, it's them. It's not you.
Well, you know, marriage is it completes creation.
Mm.
That's it's the ultimate goal, and it's the completion. It's, you know, shalom and, in a house, a house where there's peace. And so many times, our older son, Michael, would be out in the world, and he would be, you know, with his family, and he would come back and just visit us, and he would just come into the house, and the first thing he would say is, "There's great peace here. I don't see it anywhere else," and it's so astounding to him that it's just it overwhelms him, you know, and that's a good thing, you know. But in some households, when you walk into the house, it's just the opposite.
Yes.
You know. Yes. It's like you're not coming home to a peaceful place. Mm. But there's great peace in our home. Mm. That's a good sign. Yes. That's because Yahuwah is part of our marriage, you know. Mm. He's the one that joined us together, and he's never left us. He's always been with us. And in the bad times and the good times, and I'm not talking just financially. It's, you know, I'm talking about he's there, you know. Mm. And we've always sensed it in one another, you know. Mm.
I think if your study and your research does not bring you to a place where you feel more love and joy and peace, and I know we're all in a process and Yahusha's guiding us and reproving and loving and showing us things, but I think if we are not, we need to face ourselves. And this is about our walk, not about our knowledge, about our walk. Love, joy, peace, but all those things, like you said, in your home there's peace. Well, peace and love and joy, those things have to be coming out of us. So when we type things and when we say things and when we are expressing ourselves, I think we should be tapping into that place, because that's where Yahusha is. The knowledge is, he'll give you the words to say, and I'm not saying we shouldn't study or research, the opposite, but I'm saying when that becomes your focus, that's just like religion. That's lifting yourself up on something that I can do. I'm quite clever and I've got a good memory, so if I learn all this, I will appear clever. You know, and that's not it.
You don't have to be clever. All you have to do is just be an empty vessel and make yourself available. That's all he asks. And he'll take over. The rest of it is all him. It's not you. It's not about you. Mm. It's about the lost. And he's reaching out through his body to find the lost and to show his love in his body for the lost. And if the body hates its own body, you know, and if the outsiders are seeing all this strife and hatred and judgmentalism and things, doctrinal disputes over non-issues, you know, it's not a good thing, you know. Mm. We need to reflect his love for the lost and what he did for them, you know, share the truth. And they missed that point. A lot of people, and that's probably the virgins that are not wise. They don't have the oil in their lamp. They've ran out. You know, their lamps are going out because they don't have his life in them, you know, to share, not only with others, but with themselves. But we, on the other hand, have to keep the oil that's in our lamp in order to show that we've got the oil, you know. You know, the oil is a misunderstood thing a lot of times, but people understand that it's not, these are metaphors, you know. Mm. It's his life is mostly what it is. The Ruach HaKodesh, people say, it is him. It's him. It's not so much, like you say, knowing how to show off with all this wisdom and having a great memory about scripture. I foul up all the time remembering where scriptures are, but the whole point, though, is understanding and knowing him. And if you know him, then he knows you, you know. I mean, he really does know who belongs to him. And all you have to do to determine whether or not a tree is a good tree or not is to just inspect the fruit. Say, well, what's this fruit, you know, and get to know the person. It isn't so much that we have to find an organization. You have to find him. If you can find him, that's all, you know. We're not trying to lead anybody, you know, but we are able to lead if we introduce him to them, you know, because he can take over in their lives. And Yahusha's more than capable of guiding people into the truth. Mm. We don't have to worry about what the Talmud said about an issue, because he never quoted the Talmud.
No.
I'm not saying that it's not got some truth in it. I'm saying that that's not the focus. Yeah. Mm.
Well, the thing I've noticed about, and I mean, the first few years of our relationship, brother, we were just emailing, so it's not like we can say we were expressing, like we're face-to-face. We're still not really. But I noticed, the one thing that I did notice is that when you write emails, and 90% of what you write is just scripture anyway, because that scripture explains itself. When I noticed that you write emails, you walk away from reading your emails and you feel uplifted. Even if you were being taught something that, or confronted about something, or shown something, or even possibly rebuked, how is the person going to walk away from an email, from a confrontation with you? That's what I'd like to share with brothers and sisters. How is somebody going to walk away from just hanging out with you? When someone receives an email from you, how are they going to feel? And I'm not saying we have to be lovey-dovey all the time. Sometimes we have to say, look, what you're doing is wrong. Yeah. But how are you going to tell them? You know, how are you going to express it? How do you want that person to feel? Mm-hmm. It's about considering one another in a marriage. And we're all in this marriage. We're all in Yahushua and with each other, with our wives, with our husbands, and in the body as well.
Yeah, we're all in this together. And the salvation, or the redemption that we have all partaken of, is something that is just mind-blowing. And, you know, all you can do is just put your hand over your mouth and shut up, you know, because it leaves one speechless, you know. And for him to look at one of us bickering about the other one, you know, it's just wrong, you know. It's heartbreaking for him. I know that. But I know I'd been seeing it for years when I would look at email conversations with these other groups that were bantering around on the internet for years. Over 10 years ago, I saw this back and forth hatred, doctrinal arguments, and I was going, oh my, I hope they get this thing cleared up and that they come to some sort of an agreement, because the bickering was just unbelievable, you know. They were doing everything that the world does, except they weren't using the colorful metaphors. But the vitriol was elevated, you know.
Yeah.
And
do you find that you are looked down upon and treated kind of like you're a bit dumb or stupid because you don't want to engage in those what might be considered clever, sarcastic, witty? Do you find that you are sort of like, oh, don't worry about Lou, he doesn't know what we're talking about? Do you find that as Nazarene, if you actually want to do it properly, you're going to be considered a bit of a dum-dum?
I'm not sure I understand. Are they saying that about me now?
Oh, no, they're not saying it, but I'm saying in order to maintain face and appear intellectual, you've always got to come back. You've got to come back and stay in the fight, stay in the...
I usually don't. I usually don't reply at all, or I don't respond with anger, because, you know, when you've got two logs that are close together that are having a problem, you just remove one of the logs and the other one can't help but go out. It cools off. And that's my policy. It's and I'm figuring that what happens is the other person goes, well, I must have been right. That's what they usually say. Well, I must have been right because you didn't reply. But it gives them pause, though, and it gives them the time to think and contemplate. And then somewhere in the echo chamber, maybe they'll hear, love one another, you know, and I am with you always. And, you know, the goal is love, and it's not about being right or wrong about an issue. And, you know, I just hope people can get over themselves and not feel like they have to win every argument, you know. And just because a person withdraws, that's a good thing. In fact, if you read Proverbs enough, you'll see that the person that withdraws is actually the more noble, performing the more noble thing. Because the person that still wants to stand there and sword fight is, and use scripture improperly.
Yeah.
You know, like some of the issues that we have to deal with, that people are inventing all the time, there's new ones coming down the line. look what I found. And they hold it up and they say, this is it. This is a secret that's been hidden away for thousands of years. You know,
yeah.
Well, we're, in a way, doing that because we're saying, look at this. There's a secret that's been hidden away thousands of years. Obey the commandments. How incredible. Who would have thought a thing like that would be possible? Yeah. Well, you know, and then they're up there saying, thumping on their desk saying, there's no one that could obey the commandments. Yeah.
That's insane.
Well, maybe nobody wants to, but maybe somebody that wants to will be able to obey them because he will enable that person and will... why would you not want to obey the commandments? Are the commandments not wonderful? You know? And you just have to surrender. You know? But the people put themselves on their throne of their heart, and they just look at the world through the eyes of, or the mind of the flesh, and their perspective. And from that perspective, there's no way to obey, because the heart of man is not able to obey. But when you understand that Yahushua comes in, he enthrones himself, and he gives you the will to obey, and then you're okay. Because it's not you who lives, but he who lives through you, in you. And you're a vessel. When you realize you're a vessel, then he can use you, you know. And you're just a lamp, you know. You're the lamp, and he's the oil, and the light just comes through. You know, it's that easy. But when we're always picking around, go ahead.
I was just going to say, people just want to argue everything, don't they? Pick out stuff and argue and just withdraw, just withdraw, just walk out of the room.
Yeah.
Just walk out.
Same way. Yeah.
Yeah.
But, the one that speaks last doesn't necessarily win an argument, you know. Just because they have the last word. But I know who's going to have the last word.
Yes.
Yes. And if we know him, then we can just let him have the last word and keep... We're all on a narrow road anyway, and we're sometimes knocking one another off the road, and we should be rescuing each other, pulling each brother and sister back from the abyss. Because it's literally life and death. And life and death is in the power of the tongue.
Yes.
So we have to be careful what we say to one another. If we're not encouraging one another, then we must not be, we must be discouraging one another.
Yes.
Yes.
You know. That's a bad sign. Well, I've come to the end of my slides on this topic, but is there any other questions or observations?
No, I'm at the end of my slides too.
Yeah.
No, that's a very fully rounded understanding of marriage. I think we've gone off in all sorts of directions, but the core thing of marriage is, should be very clear to those to those who maybe have been neglecting their marriage, to those who are coming into marriage. There's a lot of information in scriptural text in where you've gone today, brother. It's wonderful.
When you look at it, marriage as a lifetime commitment, a human lifetime isn't that long, and you can get through it. It's actually, for me, my marriage has been a wonderful experience, and we've had our ups and downs. That's true. Everybody does. But the thing of it is, on the whole, marriage is the best choice to make. And make that commitment rather than just living together and saying, oh, we're not really married, you know.
Yeah.
They just don't understand, you know.
Yeah.
But, raising righteous offspring, you know, be fruitful and multiply. That command stands, and I think it was one of the first ones. So, you know, we should do that, you know.
Mm.
And he doesn't want to just make offspring. He wants to be fruitful and multiply, you know, and also raise the righteousness in our children, because we have to teach them and train them in his righteousness, you know, not some secular ideals, you know. You think you have enough material then?
Oh, more than enough material, brother.
All right. Well, I'll be seeing you guys later then.
Yeah.
And we'll get together.
Yeah.
What's the next one? About a month from now, I guess.
Yeah, we're flowing from here. We can go into the New Jerusalem, the bride, the Lamb's wife.
Oh, that'd be a perfect flow.
Yeah.
Okay.
The fulfillment.
Yeah.
So, love you, brother.
Love you, and we'll see you next time.
Yep. We'll do.
Okay.
See you later.
Bye-bye.
So, brothers and sisters, the thing I want to leave you with today, the way you treat your spouse and the way you treat other people, your neighbor, is the way you are treating Yahusha. So go over these scriptures again and again, brothers and sisters, and go deeper into your marriage relationship with your spouse and with your Creator, Yahusha, our wonderful Messiah. Thank you for sticking through all these parts, brothers and sisters, with me. It's been an amazing seminar. So be it, and bye-bye.
Let us be glad and rejoice and give Him praise. Let us be glad. Let us be glad and rejoice and give Him praise. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and His wife hath prepared herself. Let us be glad and rejoice and give Him praise. Hallelujah, for El Shaddai reigns. Hallelujah, for El Shaddai reigns. Worship Elohim. Blessed are all those who have been chosen. Worship Elohim. Call to the marriage supper of